Crocs was it in 1979, he was in denial. He couldn't believe he didn't have a majority, and he soon found that he didn't have a majority and lost a vote. We had an election. But some of our minority parliaments and governments have been highly productive. Two of Mr. King's, I think, were, but more recent, getting a little closer in our time, two of Mike Pearson's, he probably only had two, minority governments were extremely productive on very controversial issues. That's when we got our Medicare, that's when we got the Canadian Pension Plan, that's when we even, what could be more divisive, got our flag, all with a minority government and a minority parliament. I think a pretty productive recent period of minority government were the first 18 months of the Harper first minority government, from the time he got elected in 2004 for the first 18 months. And what Mr. Harper did, he reached out, and boy, if you don't reach out, you're not going to get anything done. I always just stop and say, just do the math. If you haven't got a majority of seats and you need a majority vote for your policies, you got to find some allies. And Harper found allies on his budget. He found the NDP on fiscal relations and federal fiscalism. He reached out to the Bloc on Afghanistan. He reached out and somewhat divided the Liberals, but he did work with them on Afghanistan and eventually put together the Manley Commission, led by a former Deputy Liberal Prime Minister. So, and it was a pretty productive period. He got all of his, not all, almost all of his election platform into law. So that 18 months surely shows that minority parliaments aren't inherently unproductive and dysfunctional. But they are now, and we got to think about why. The first solution, and the first thing that has to change to make our minority parliament we have now more productive is a behavioral change. And I want to just read you, if I may, the concluding paragraph of this United Kingdom report. This was written in January 2010, so this is pretty up to date. And they were watching all through 2009 our dysfunctional parliament perform. And here's what they say: for minority government to work in Canada, there needs to be a dramatic shift in political culture, which emphasizes cooperation and accommodation. And when I read this out, some people say, Peter, you're on another planet. But anyway, they go on. Which emphasizes cooperation and accommodation rather than conflict and partisanship. I don't know about a whole change of culture, but I went up to Ottawa a couple of days before the opening of the session and I spoke to politicians. I got a hearing in one caucus, the Liberal caucus, and I really said it isn't a matter of putting, forgetting your Conservatives or Liberals or NDP and Bloc. It's accepting the reality of the parliament the Canadian people have produced and are likely to produce in future elections. One in which none of you have a majority, none of your parties are very popular. You don't sweep the country. So you have to reach out. If you just say, my gosh, my Liberal policy, my Conservative policy, that's it, do or die. Well, you can't operate. You simply can't operate in a minority parliament that way. And look at the issues, from employment insurance to Afghanistan and so on. I don't see, and I haven't heard, any big ideological gulf between the Conservatives and other opposition parties on many of those issues. There are shades of difference and so on. So you have to reach out, and that's how the other 45 to 46 or 7 other parliamentary democracies that normally have minority parliaments, that's what they do. The parties don't set aside partisanship. They just accept the reality of they're in a house of minorities. And if they're going to get anything done, any legislation or policy, it always has to have the support of the majority in the House, you got to reach out. And if you're busy sniping, paying at each other, paying money for attack ads, and saying the leader of that other party is a real dope and a jerk and worse than that, how can you then sit down and say, well, now, let's look at employment insurance or policy. You know, Michael, I mean, or Stephen, that's you can't do that. So that kind of acceptance of reality has to occur. I don't know whether it will. I'm a little bit more hopeful that a message is getting through that Canadian people do not want another dysfunctional parliament. So that's a behavioral change. Part of it, and I think the evidence as to whether anything's happening will come on this part, is the use of committees. And all the parliaments of the world, really, where the getting together occurs is mainly in committees. Now, as we know, in this last year, in 2009, the Prime Minister issued a handbook on how to make sure the committees of Parliament don't work, can't produce anything. I went before one in March, just a year ago, on appointing judges, and it was so bad that a couple of young conservatives came up to me at the end after I and the president of the Canadian Bar Association had talked about a reform in appointing judges, which the conservatives were very much in favor of when they were in opposition. And they managed to make sure the whole committee couldn't even deal with the subject. And they knew me as a professor, and I have an honorary degree from one of the universities up there, and I taught them up there. And they apologized. They said, this is terrible. And I said, but their careers were at stake. They had these instructions. So just watch to see if the committee system can begin to work. In terms of speakers for your organization, I'd like to mention a very good study of how to make committees work a little better by a very knowledgeable person, Tom Axworthy, who heads up the Center for the Study of Democracy at Queen's. And it's about an 80-page report, very detailed about how to make committees work better, the kind of reforms there. None of it is rocket science, it's pretty straightforward. And I think of some of Tom's very good ideas, which, by the way, have been endorsed by many people that I know on the conservative side of politics, so it's not entirely hopeless. I think we'd have a better problem. But that's the sort of behavioral revolution change that has to occur right away if we're not going to be plunged back into, what, our fourth election in 6 years? That would be something. I want to turn, though, to the more urgent constitutional issue. It concerns something called conventions of our Constitution. I always apologize when I put that word out, because they're these sort of spooky things. Where the hell are those conventions? You know, they're not in the books. They're up in the attics of our collective memory, and we pull them down, we hope. But the thing, first of all, you may know all this now, but some of you may not, the Westminster model, which is our model of parliamentary democracy for obvious reasons, it came over from Great Britain, is a model in which there are generally very few legal, you hear that word legal? Rules, written down in law. I mean, the rule that the Crown, in whom our Constitution invests all executive power, is in the hands of the Queen, our Queen. I'm going to say the Queen of the UK, the Queen of Canada. And the rule that the Queen or her representative in Canada, the Governor General, must act on the advice